I work with HackerRank currently as software engineer, and I work mostly with the front-end team. I'm from NSIT, Delhi, and I got into HackerRank through, I think, 3 years back through internship, and then I got PPO from HackerRank. Before that, I had my own startups. In college, I completed most of my internships in first year itself, and then I started my own startup. One was a mentorship-based startup, like you can book mentorship, calls from people who are already in Google, Microsoft, or so. It was a mentorship platform, basically. They can guide you and how to for a better career progression. Second was a fintech startup where we created an app so that people from US can send money to India through blockchain. So we raised fund for that, and that was acquired by a Philippines-based investor. After that, I joined HackerRank, and I thought I'll gain some industry experience. So yes, also currently I am mentoring students with DevNest. So that's about me. So let's move. So just quick question. What do you think is more important, like learning in the long term, or, you know, career-wise, building you as a like polishing yourself as a good developer? What do you think is the most important, like learning fundamentals or learning a framework like React or Angular or Vue, something like that? Learning both of them is fine, like none of them is bad, but I just want to hear, you can post an answer, like, so I'm getting JS fundamentals. Is it like it is written fundamentals because we have been told we should learn fundamentals, or is there a strong reasoning behind it? Anyone can answer it. Like let's keep it open. You know, if somebody wants to speak, they can do that. So most of the answers are JS fundamentals, and you are right. See, if you know JS fundamentals or any fundamentals of any programming language like Python, JavaScript, or C++, whatnot. So framework doesn't matter. Let's say now there is a job, there is a startup, or there is a company who is hiring for, let's say, Angular developer. But you have learned React. Now what you will do? You will go back and learn Angular, right? But that doesn't make sense. So if you know JavaScript, like from the roots, like how does it work internally, then you will become framework agnostic. You won't care about framework as such. Yes, you need to learn framework, but you need to understand at least one layer below what you're working on. Let's say in React, we do imports, and we have functional components, we have class components. So beneath that, we need to understand what is class. What is class? There is no class. There are no classes in JavaScript. It is just a sugar-coated syntax of functions, right? So once we know that, that fear will be removed, right? Any framework can expose you all the keywords, fancy keywords like that. But if you understand how, you know, JavaScript works under the hood, you will be like fearless, and you'll be like, I can now crack any framework. I don't care. It's just, I need to get the right opportunity. I know the basics. So yes, let's move forward. So what do you think is the best way to get into your dream company? Well, let's ask, like, what is your dream company? Yeah, everyone post your dream company in the chat. Sabki dream company hogi, right? Everyone must be like, have a vision. I see myself somewhere in this company, XYZ company, after X years, or like say 5 years or 2 years, or maybe immediately. Just post your dream company and don't say HackerRank. Or, well, you can say HackerRank, but yeah. It depends, like what where do you see yourself, like Google, Microsoft, or maybe a startup running your own company? You can run your own company as well, but yeah, everyone please do post, then we can, like, you know, let's make it interactive. You can use chat, or you can speak up as well. No dream companies? Amazon, okay. Uber, all right. Amazon, Uber, got it. Then, so if you tell me what's your dream company, then we can, like, you know, discuss how each company's mindset works while hiring. So that will be helpful. So yes, most of them, your posters, like, they're big companies. Like, everyone wants to go into big companies because, yeah, the money is good, right? So what is the best way to get into your dream company? So best way is internships. Like, So that is the easiest way, because interviews there, like while they hire interns, the interview bar is very low. Like it's easy to get an internship than cracking that rigorous in DSLGO interview. The questions are like easier, it's not up to that level of like when you apply as a full-time developer, but it's relatively easier. And it's relatively easier to get internships also, because company has to pay less, and a lot of cost saving is also involved when, you know, they offer internships. So question is like, how do you get internships? Like, what is the best way to get an internship? So let's say if you are from a tier one college, like DTU, NSIT, IIT. So a lot of your seniors must be going into these colleges. Must be going into these companies like Google, Microsoft, Yuki. These companies come and they offer campus placements, right? But what about if you're not from that college, you don't have that network, then how do you do it? Maybe one way is maybe your cousin or some of their relative is already working in the Google and they can refer you, right? Mostly in colleges like NSIT, DTU, IIT, how it works is you ask your seniors to they refer you, and you can also apply directly. And since there is a credibility that you are from a good college like IIT or NIT, companies are willing to take a chance and they are willing to invest some amount that at least you have proved some worth in your life. Like, you have done something. You have cracked one of the toughest exams in India, and you have been in the IIT or NSIT, whatever, or DTU, and you have been there. So that's a proof that company thinks like, this guy or this girl has done something in his or her life. I can, spend some time, let's see how it goes. And that is not necessary that he or she will be good at computer science, or they are good at, they might be good at programming or not. They cracked that physics or chemistry exam better. That is the only thing they did. And now they have worked hard, or maybe their day was good, whatever, right? But they have an advantage. They have an advantage. And it's a bias in our country that IITs and NITs get a preference. That is for sure. So, but how do you overcome that bias? How do you build your own credibility and your own brand? How do you do that? So one way, as I said, it gets easier if your friend or if your senior, if someone if you are going to a lot of meetups, you meet people, you grow your network, ask people to refer you, ask people, just, can I get an interview? Because that way it is easier. Like, if you know someone, they can just refer you and you get a chance to get an interview with that company, let's say Google, Microsoft or Uber, right? So that way it gets easier. So yeah, for big companies, you definitely need a referral, or if you are a fresher, if you are in like second year or third year, you definitely would need a referral to get into that company. Or there is one more way. Like, if you have done something really good in open source, or you have really cool projects, or maybe something you built went viral, or you got really popular, then there's other way. Then the equation changes. Like, company might reach out to you, hey, what you have built. So the only thing is, like, you have to build some brands, build some credibility, show something that you are capable of. That's why that's the only reason that company will come and invest time in you and spend that money and hire you, right? So big companies, definitely you might need a referral for if you directly want to apply internships at Google or Microsoft, you would need a connection. Second way is to reach out through LinkedIn. That's like cold calling, or you you can reach out to people who are, you can search on LinkedIn who are working at Microsoft or Google or whatever, or Uber, right? You can ask them, you can request them, hey, can you please refer me? The problem with that is I personally get, I think so far for HackerRank, I have got, I think, thousands of messages till now. And total for 20 positions at HackerRank, there are like 10,000 applicants in our ATS system. Like, ATS is like where people apply, and when you apply online, that your application comes. 8,000 applications for 20 positions. Like, I was like, what is going on? And how do I differentiate? I was screening the resumes and I was like, how do I differentiate who stands out, or how do I do that? So I was like skimming through the resumes and all that, right? So how do you stand out? Like, you 8,000, like let's say I give you 8,000 resumes. How do you do the processing of, you know, finding who is the best, who is the right candidate? So you have to stand out. Like you have to be unique. You have to be different from those 8,000 applications, right? Then only like you will get a chance. So we'll talk about how you can be different. But first, understand the mindset of how these big companies hire, how well-funded, you know, companies hire, and how early stage startups hire. So for each of these, we have established that you need some credibility, you need some projects, you need some like open source contributions to, you know, show them that you are different, right? So for big companies, it is important that you understand the basics like problem solving, data structures. So that is very important. For well-funded companies, I would say for big companies, example like Microsoft, Google, maybe Amazon, right? Or Uber, you can include. For well-funded companies like, let's say HackerRank is one, and Lyft is in US though, or Dunzo, or you can say Zomato. All these are like upcoming startups. Like those are like Series B, Series C funded. For them, problem solving is important, but not that important. For them, projects are more important. Like what you have done, what you have actually solved in like for a person or for a company or for in general, what you have done, what have you created? What, let's say you have written a library which has been used by like hundreds or thousands of people, or you have created a Chrome extension, or you have created a NPM package, something like that. You have to like for them, that is important. That stands out. For early stage startups, it's kind of same. Like they might focus less on DSLGO, but yeah, that is important. But for them, it is not that important. For them, execution is important. They want someone who knows things, who knows and, you know, get things running. So let's say for early stage startup, it would be like, if you know that framework, if you know React or if you know Angular, so that you can join the same day and start coding. That's for them. Like, because early stage startups are like 2 or 3 or maybe 10 member team who have raised $1 or $2 million, right? Something like that. And that is a good opportunity to start with. Like, you know, you get to learn a lot and the entry barrier is low. Like, although you won't get as much as benefits in like, you know, getting into big companies, but it's a good start to have and good learning curve. You'll get to learn a lot of things. So for early stage startups, it's important that you know things. You know, you have built something, you have built few projects using React, or you built few projects using JavaScript or anything, or maybe what you can explore what tech stack they're using, and you can build something, and you can, one of the interview round would be like, they'll give you a assignment where you have to build an application, let's say food delivering app, and you have to code it and then explain the code or what you're doing. So that is a difference between the mindset of these companies. I hope that is clear, and we can, you know, take questions in the end. So how do you stand out? I think we have discussed it. We have touched this topic lightly, but how do you stand out? Like in this crowd, like everybody is trying to do something different. Everyone is trying to be unique, right? And it's if you open LinkedIn and everybody is posting their success stories, they have built this, that. How do you stand out? So the best way to build a project or best way to do something is solve an actual problem. No matter how small it is, no matter how big it is, just solve it. Like if you see a problem for yourself or for a friend or someone, try to solve it through tech or, you know, anything. Like I'll give you an example, you know, later in the slide, like how I solved a very like basic problem of clicking a button. Yeah. So that's how you stand out, like solving a real problem, working on a real project. And the best way to do it is start a startup in college. I think that's the best way you can, you know, solve a problem. I learned a lot through 2 or 3 startups which I've done in the college. Like 2 of them failed like badly, and the third one was like decent one, like successfully had a like decent exit. But yes, the learning was like tremendous. Like I was doing marketing, I was doing coding, I was handling infrastructure, I was hiring people, I was even cleaning desks. Like even that was part of the job. Like we were 3 people, we were 3 co-founders, and we were hustling. Like we were talking to investors. We were, you know, you learn life, you learn a lot of things, not just code. You learn how to talk to people. You learn like how to solve a problem, how to go about solving a problem. How do you, you know, do digital marketing, whatnot. Like you then you can explore like what's best for you, and then you can, you know, like carve out your career path using that. So the best way is to like start a startup. And I think the college is the best time to start a startup because you don't have any financial liability. You have nothing to lose. All you have to juggle between your exams and this, that's that, and you have to maybe skip few parties and all. But yes, that is, I think that's worth it. If you really want to, you know, be different in your life or you want to do something. So that's a good way to start. Second way is you can start contributing to open source. How we'll do that, we'll discuss that as well. Or maybe you can work on anything, any project which is like meaningful or solving some actual problem, can be used by your friends or can be used by people in general. So that will help you, you know, stand out. And highlight that, highlight in your resume, highlight when you pitch. A lot of students message me on LinkedIn. Hey, sir, I have solved this much lead code problems. I have done this. I'm good at DSL Go. But how you will prove it to me? Like, you know, how, why I'll spend my time and energy in referring you or, you know, like thinking about how do I refer you? I can do that. I do that for a lot of students. But what will motivate me? Like, you know, you have to prove that. In order to prove that, host your projects online. Give me a link. Just start with it. Like, you know, hey, just check this out. This will blow your mind. Send one simple line and build a kick-ass project. And I think there's no way a company will not hire you if you are really good and if you really learned. I don't think there would be a problem if you have right skill sets. So people like, I think nowadays like students are like, yeah, we'll just text and, you know, we'll see how it goes. They're not willing to work. Maybe they are, but I don't know. Like I don't see much that zeal and zest nowadays. But yes, you can do it. You should do it. That's the way. So how do you crack internship interviews? Internship interviews are fairly easy. Like if you have done a lot of projects, if you have done GSOC or you have been part of open source community in general, or you have, I think, Google groups, right? If you're part of these and you have been actively contributing to something or the other, internship interviews gets relatively easy. So one round would be like, you know, talk about what you have done so far. So that will be one round. Second round would be like the behavioral round, like what's your career goal, you know, how do you deal with your friends and all that. So that would be one round. One round would be like problem solving and basic data structures round. I'm talking general, like I think Google and Microsoft, all these big companies focus more on DSL Go. That's their pattern. But big companies and startups will, like well-funded startups will see your projects. Like they'll mostly focus on your projects. You know, like, yeah, yeah, you have to build some cool projects to showcase them, or you have done some startup thing as we have discussed. So yes, prepare for problem solving and data structures. Prepare good projects on GitHub, host them. Don't just host your code. By the way, that a lot of people, what I will see, like I don't have time to go through your code. Make it functional, host it on a server, like give me that live link, demo it. So that is easy for me. I'll just spend 30 seconds and I'll see, hi, this guy has done something, like, you know, let's give him a chance. So that will, you know, automatically, like I'll see this guy has worked or this girl has worked so hard. And that will be like a gratitude. Like I'll work towards referring you or, you know, giving you a chance, or like I'm talking as a founder. So let's say you got the internship, everything, and how do you convert that internship into a job? How do you get pre-placement offers? I think that is very simple. Like things get easy once you get into a company. The only criteria of getting hired from internship to a full-timer is we have given something to you and you have done it. Like anything given to, let's say, Shivu or Aditi, right? She or he is capable of delivering it on time and before time. If you have done that with good engineering practices, with good quality code, and talking to people, you know, like taking mentorship and you are collaborating with all your mentors and friends and on that project, and you have delivered it, whatever was assigned to you, you will get the job. So it is easier for a company to give you a PPO rather than like hiring, you know, spending four rounds on a regular interview, because they know that how you work, they have seen your work. So if you got a internship, that is the best and easiest way to convert into a job. Like, you know, just work hard. like work and deliver things. Have fun, but like be serious about your work. So a lot of the now, like there's a trend of like front end engineering in general. Like I've seen from last 2-3 years, the trend has grown and people want like specialized skills. Like there is now front end engineering, there is back end engineering, data science. Now that we have categories, right? So what do you expect in a JavaScript interview or a front end interview in general? So I think if the job description is front end or JavaScript engineer or something of that sort, so be ready with the basics. Like they won't ask you React, no matter how good you are. They might ask you React a bit, but mostly they will focus on JavaScript fundamentals, like how promises works, how event loop works, how JavaScript works beneath the hood. And there are concepts like throttling, debouncing, and like closures, like what are the application of closures, how inheritance works. So the questions can be tricky as well, like because JavaScript, the way JavaScript works, you have to really dig deep into it. Sometimes I also get stuck while I teach. So like no problem, but yeah, you at least you know most of the things, right? I mean, you know most how things work in general and you are able to convert that into code. And it's good to have understanding of CSS as well, how CSS works and how you can apply layouts. At least you can convert some design into a mentor model and, you know, convert it. Let's say one of the rounds would be, if you are interviewing for internship or full-time, mostly for full-time, this will be like machine coding round. Machine coding round would be write an app, like WhatsApp-like app, design a WhatsApp, like something like that. So with minimum features, not the full WhatsApp, you'll be given like 1 or 2 hours to code it, and you have to take your laptop. Now it is like, I think the COVID situation, but you have to do it in your machine and you have to record the screen while you are coding it. So that is one of the rounds. And in that round, you will be given nothing. You'll be just given with the problem statement and you have to clarify what you have to build with that interviewer at that time. And So imagine something like this. You have given, let's say, WhatsApp or a food delivering app or something like Amazon. You have to build Amazon, and there'll be like open-ended questions, like, and you have to really ask the interviews. Like, so the best way to approach this round is clear beforehand what are the features you will be building, what all we will delivering, like, and discuss with your interviewer what will be the data structures, like what will the data, how you will be storing the data, is it like offline first, and all those things you have to discuss with your interviewer. If you don't do that, the problem statements become very open and you don't have clear goals and the time is very limited, right? So for this is especially true for startups, like early stage startups and well-funded startups, like the other two, like I think Swiggy, Zomato, and all these companies, even Uber, have, I think, machine coding around, especially for front-end guys. And Udaan, I guess, Udaan also has front-end machine coding around. So yes, companies who are like willing to pay a lot, but they want someone who can quickly think a mental model. So first thing you have to do is create a mental model, like how your design will look like. You have some idea, like there is a cart button on the top, and there will be like some cards which would be like listing these products, right? For, let's say, for Amazon. So you have to quickly, there'll be search bar. And so you have to quickly come up with this and tell your interviewer, like, I'll be building this. And you have to sign off on this, like, you know, hey, I'll be building this in the 2 hours. And then you have to start coding that. And it doesn't have to be a very good design, but the layout should be good. And they will check if your design is mobile responsive or not, if you are able to do that or not, are you able to apply media queries and make it responsive for phone, tablet, or so. In that 2 hours, you have to apply all your knowledge and create the best out of it. For example, a very basically, you can in how do you optimize that app? Like in search bar, you can apply debouncing to limit the server calls. Like that will save a lot of cost for servers. Like you can, so when you type, you don't want the API call to happen on every keystroke, right? So when the user will stop, then only you want to make an API call and fetch the results. This is called debouncing. And one more thing you can do is, like, you can create an auto suggest feature. Like when you type in, you already have the data from the back end, then you can just populate that. So yes, I mean, for some of you, it might look, some of the things might look very advanced, but yes, this, these are the questions which are being asked nowadays for entry level, you know, for SD1, SD2 positions, or even for very good companies, they even ask for internships as well. So at least try to code something in like 2 hours or 3 hours, practice things like discuss it with your friends or mentors, whatever, right? So what do product companies in generally look for? Like, I think there is now a trend of service companies and product companies, and everyone wants to go into product companies because of the culture, I guess. And that's true. Like, the product companies are mostly, they inherited their culture from US, and the culture is very open-minded. Like, if you have seen all these US companies, they have like unlimited leaves. So we have unlimited leaves at HackerRank. We can take, not like we don't work for whole year. It's like we can, we have flexibility, and we don't have leave count like other companies. Even a lot of big companies have leave count, like Samsung, Amazon, they have like 28 leaves per year. But we can, our philosophy is like, do your work and we don't care whatever you do. So that is the culture I like to work in. Basically, you have control of your life. If you want to have fun, finish your work and have fun, right? So what do product companies look for? And a lot of these product companies have this kind of culture. I think Cred is one of the upcoming startups. Even Swiggy has this culture, and I think a lot of these popular companies have this sort of product company culture. So what do they look for? They look for someone who can, you know, build something really fast, and someone who has good work ethic. So what is work ethic? Like, if you're committing to something, you know, if you're committing that I will do this in 1 week, I'll do this in 2 hours, or I'll do this in like 15 days, you have to stick to your words that I will deliver it no matter how. I'll give an example at HackerRank. So I was challenged by the CTO once at HackerRank when I was interning that, you know, build this feature. And I committed without specking out how much time that feature will take. I just committed, I think it's easy. I think it will be done in 1 week or something like that. But when I discussed that feature with my seniors and all, they said like, I think that this will take a month at least. I was like, now I am screwed. So, but what I did then, I think I stayed in the office. We had this separate room where you can, you know, rest and sleep. I stayed in office for 4 days straight, 3 or 4 days straight. And I coded it. Like, a lot of my mentors helped, who were like, you know, there to help me. And I stayed there because I committed it. So that's what they look for. And I think when I got the full-time offer, I was given because of this reason only, because I committed something and I delivered it no matter how. And doesn't mean you ignore your health in that way. I did that, nobody else's. So the better approach would have been, I would have specced it out initially. Now I've learned that, but yes. The point is, stick to your work, have good work ethic, and, you know, deliver whatever you are being assigned or whatever done. And yes, basic problem solving and all that goes, I think, for the product companies as well. So how do you start with front-end development? It was like, most of you have already done it. I think most of you are already in front-end development, and I'm assuming. But let's say you want to start with front-end development, what's your first step? I think if you don't have it, if you've never coded HTML or CSS or JS in your life, I would suggest you to go to MDN, that's Mozilla Docs. Start reading about what is HTML, what is web, and what is JS. And from there, they have very good documentation about what is JavaScript and how it works. And then I think try to develop a basic game or, you know, basic application. Then you'll get confidence in the syntax and everything. So that's how you can start with front-end development. And it's a really good scope in terms of job security, if you talk about. You see, everything is front-end, right? Like most of these applications, Flipkart, every application has a front face where you can interact with which you can interact with and, you know, give inputs to and talk to the backend. So I think it's very good in terms of career trajectory. If you want stability in your life, and it's a good skill, to have, like it's a good field to go into. The one of the main questions I said we'll take on later is, how do you start with open source? I said, okay, let me just show you something. So for open source, you have to do very basic stuff. Like, if you have a problem, let's say, I'll give you an example. This is my GitHub. And I think last year I faced a problem where I was watching Netflix and that skip intro button was, I need to press it again and again. I said, there should be a way to, like, you know, automate this. And it, in Prime itself, there is the same problem that you have to skip intros and recaps to come to the main content. So I developed this extension where you install it like this one and you get your problem is solved. Like, you don't get any ads. You don't get your next episode is skipped. Your previous episode is, like, the recaps are skipped and everything. So these are the features I listed and all that. And I made it open source. Like I said, ki people are welcome to contribute, and they did. Like, I have like 5 contributors and all. And I think if I go check insights today, I think it has around 3,000 users, and it has been used around like 400K times, like 472K times it has, the skip event has been clicked so far. So the point is, start somewhere, start small, and your thing will grow, and, you know, it will get popular and get used by many people. So in Chrome Web Store, if you see, it has now 2.5, it shows it round off number, but it has like 2,500 users, somewhere around that, and people have rated it and all that. So you get to two things. Like, you get to learn a lot here, and you get emails from people across the world that, you know, hey, your extension is not working, or maybe you can improve this. And then you get a lot of pull requests as well. So if you see a problem, solve it. Like, you know, if you're like, it was as basic as like clicking a button, and, you know, I just solved it and posted it as open source, and people are using it. So that is very small thing, like, example. Another is like the match rules. It's a NPM package I wrote for, you can just install it, and it's like a business logic matcher for front end. You can pass certain rules and source. If you don't have any problem to solve, you can just, that's the most of the easiest ways to go is go to GitHub and whatever language you are comfortable with. It's not front end specific. You can search for Python as well. Let's say JavaScript. I'm searching JS. Select JS as a language and see what all popular libraries are there, like, which have decent number of stars, at least 10 stars or 5 stars or at least that, and which are, and filter it by the most recent. So that's the way you can merge it. Recently updated. See recently updated, and you'll see 24 stars, 2.8K stars. 1 minute ago. So it is very recent, and it means they are actively, you know, merging the PRs, adding code to their master and all that. So see their code, see how you can solve them. There are GitHub issues posted. Start with some basic issues. Start with whatever you feel like and whatever skill set you have, whatever you can solve it. So start with that. That is the best way. Like, GitHub issues are the best way to start with. And it can be as simple as adding a comma, as simple as adding a semicolon, or improving the documentation. That way you can, you know, get into open source. You will see how community works, how pull requests are merged, how you can assign the pull request. Then you can go on creating your own NPM packages and, you know, creating your own repositories as well. You can start with that as well, but yes. So that was about, I think I got mute. So that was about open source. And I think that was it from my side. I think we are open to questions if you have any. You can connect with me on GitHub, LinkedIn, and Twitter. This is my handle. If you Google it, you will find my channels. And please join the DevNest community. The link will be shared. And I'm open to questions if you have any. Just, you know, ask anything.
Sir, I'm Pranav.
Hey, Pranav.
Yeah. Sir, I built websites for my friend. She have two means, like NGO startup type. So okay. She wants to collect the donations. So is it count as a project? Means I have delivered the website to her. So can I show that, okay, I have made this website and is live?
Definitely, that's one of the good ways. Like, if even if you have done freelancing, right, and you can, if your website is live somewhere, you can showcase that as your project. But remember, they will ask you how you coded it and what was your, they will ask insights about, you know, what was your mindset and what was your thought process about going about solving this, and you know, how did you improve the performance or how did you add JavaScript bundles. So be ready with those questions. But yes, definitely you can show your normal projects, or let's say you work for an NGO, right? That is a really good cause also. So you can highlight that as well. Like, I build this website for an NGO, right? And you can, you know, showcase that in your resume as well. But yes, one cool thing I wanted to show, let's say some cool stuff you can do with JavaScript, you know, let's say you can make any website content editable with just one line of code. Like, you're editing a normal text page. Amazon.in, or let's say medium.com, or which is any text heavy page. Let's go. I think this question is not asked in many companies, but yes. How do you make the whole page editable like it is a document? So what do you do is document.body.content. Editable. True. So if you set it true, you can just edit anything, and then you know, obviously it's not saved because it's on the client side, but you can do cool stuff. Like, this is one of the cool stuff you can do with JavaScript, and you know, you can do it on any website like Amazon, Flipkart, or any website for that matter. You can just make it like a normal document and edit it. So yes, next question. You can go on with the question. Pranav, did that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Then I think if nobody has question, then we can. You can connect with me, and please, Vedansh, can you share? Vedansh is there?
Yes, I have shared the link in the chat. It's a WhatsApp community link where we post all these webinars, and we have a regular Algo Go competition going, and we also have weekly meetings for that, where we discuss the questions and the interview questions which might come on those topics. Enjoy that.
Yeah. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. Any doubts or anything like that, then we can, you know, close it out. Or you can write in your chat as well if you're like, if you think speaking out is something you don't want to do, you can write in chat as well. Okay. Thanks. I guess, Vedansh, are we done? Yes. I think that was the question.
Yes. Yes. If anybody has any question, feel free to reach out to Naman or like in the chat.
Yeah, you can post questions in the WhatsApp group, or you can reach out to me directly.